Plants are not only everywhere, but people are everywhere. And the interesting interactions between this combination of people that have moved all around the world and plants that are naturally moved all around the world and that people have moved around with them is really an exciting aspect of ethnobotany. Being able to see how cultures have co-evolved with plants, how plants have changed under the influence of people, and kind of in a sneaky way, how plants have shaped the evolution of culture itself. That's what our topic is today. There are several big questions that people have about distributions of plants and distributions of people and how these two kind of fit together. One of the fundamental questions that we like to address is, why is it that there are different cultures at all? Why isn't there just one human culture that's practiced all around the world? Part of the answer to that probably lies in the fact that we all have access to different kinds of resources and that we use them sometimes in the same way, but sometimes in different ways, and that we think about these resources in different ways. A second question that is often asked is, why was there variation in the usage of plants and technologies in the past? Why didn't everybody just learn how to use things and that spread around the world and we all kind of use things the same way? Why is it that during the great age of European exploration, they went around and they found that there were some people in the world that had technology that was better than they had, there were some people who had technology that wasn't as good as they had, and there were a lot of people who had technology that was just simply different than they had. And they also had plants that were just simply different. Why is it this way? Why aren't things evenly distributed? And there's kind of some subtle questions underneath all of this. And one of the ones that's kind of fun to ask is, how is it that all humans are related to each other? We can trace this through language, we can trace it through genetics, we can trace it through culture, and pertinent to what we do, you can trace it through plants. This slide illustrates the major movements of people throughout history. The dates that are listed are rough approximations of when people moved into a particular region. So you notice the smiley face on Africa shows that the hypothesized ancestral homeland of all humans is in East Africa. People moved out of Africa probably at least 1 million years ago and spread on down into Southeast Asia, up into Europe. They were in parts of Europe 500,000 years ago, across Central Asia, and then out into Australia, eventually into North and South America, and then finally into the Pacific Islands, where we'll end up with a lot of our conversations. Jared Diamond has produced a popular television series about the book that he wrote a few years ago called Guns, Germs, and Steel. Most of the content of this presentation is drawn from that book and some related sets of work. So if this sounds familiar, or if you get a chance to see his work or read his book, I highly recommend it. Within the five major regions of the world, when we consider the domestication of plants, much of this is focused upon three categories of plants that are useful for food. The first of these is large seeded grasses like corn, wheat, rice. The second is large seeded legumes such as lots of different kinds of beans like soybeans, pinto beans, things like that. And the third category is starchy roots such as taro, sweet potatoes, yams, cassava. One of the reasons that's given for there being cultural differences between development of agriculture in different parts of the world is simply that there is not an equal distribution of the members of these three categories. So if you notice, in the Mediterranean and West Asia region, there's a very large number of large-seeded grasses, there's also a large number of starchy root plants, and the largest number of large-seeded legumes. Now all of this happens to correlate with sets of animals that like to eat these kinds of plants and that would be somewhat competitors with us. This is not just an accident that it happens this way. And if you notice, by the time we get to the Indo-Pacific region, there are no large-seeded grasses. There's only one large-seeded legume, and it happens to be a tree that has to grow quite large before it's producing seeds. And there's only two native starchy root crops that we'll learn about later. So we would hypothesize by looking at a list such as this that the ability of people in different parts of the world to develop agriculture is somewhat related to the base materials that they have available for them to do such a thing. The distribution of animals that were domesticated in the past is also uneven, and in fact even more stacked against the Indo-Pacific region, which has none of the categories of animals listed. It's important to note that most of the animals that we think of as being domesticated actually come out of Asia or the edges of Europe that are adjacent to Asia. So Asia really is the source of most of the domesticated animals that we have. Well, one of the things that makes this interesting is that the continent of Africa has lots of large animals that you would think would be domesticatable, but actually very few of them have. Likewise, the Pacific Islands had lots of large birds, but we don't have evidence that any of them were actually domesticated, even though it would seem like some of them could have been. This map shows the distribution of agricultural centers. These are points in the world that we know that agriculture developed in. And for the most part, we feel that agriculture developed in each of these pretty much independent of other areas, although we do know in a few cases of sharing that occurred. The size of each of the dots that's illustrated on the map is relative to the number of species that were domesticated in that region. So you notice that the largest dot is over the Fertile Crescent area of Iraq and adjacent parts of Syria, Turkey, Israel, and so forth. And this just simply indicates that that part of the world had more domestications occur than any other part of the world. The second biggest dot occurs over the region of Mesoamerica, Mexico, Guatemala, and adjacent countries. And so this represents the area with the second biggest number of domestications that have occurred. Throughout much of this course, we're going to be concerned with the domestication that occurred within the New Guinea Center, or sometimes called the Sahul Center. And you notice that this is a much smaller dot, but that it's comparable with some of the other tropical centers in Ethiopia, parts of South America. Domestication of animals is not always a good thing. Most of the diseases that humans have are actually diseases of animals. So when you think about common childhood diseases such as chickenpox, mumps, measles, these are all diseases that are normally the diseases of animals, and we have acquired them from them. So there's a price to be paid for domesticating animals and living in close proximity to them. And this price is even greater when two cultures come in contact, one of whom has had a particular disease and has developed resistance to it, and the other of whom has not. So a general pattern that we see throughout history is that when farming cultures come in contact with non-farming cultures, or when two farming cultures come in contact with one another, and one culture uses a set of domesticated animals that the other one does not, the one that does not will suffer an epidemic of disease, and it's usually the diseases of the farm animals of the other culture. This has happened in many parts of the world, but there's particularly good historical record of this in North and South America, and in many Pacific islands, including Hawaii. As people shift to farming and start to develop the technologies that are associated with farming, they also develop the ability to maintain higher population densities within a particular environment. This is kind of a lethal cycle, because as they develop the ability to have larger populations, and they actually have larger populations, it becomes much more difficult for them to go backwards. At that point, they pretty much need to keep having agriculture in order to maintain the population that they've increased to. So some people look at agriculture as being a one-way decision. If you decide to become an agriculturalist or head down the path, there's no going back, or at least it would be very painful. Secondary aspect of farming that happens because of the technologies and because of the intensification and increase in populations is that farmers tend to change the environments in which they live more than do non-farmers. So we see farmers modifying the landscape. In order to keep the landscape that way, they also have to do a fair amount of maintenance of the landscape. So, as many people have noted, farmers actually work more than non-farmers do. And part of this is in maintaining an environment that's suitable for the kinds of plants and animals that they want. So, once again, when we see two cultures interacting with each other, if one of these cultures is a farming culture and the other one is not, the farming culture tends to have more children per person, per couple. The farming culture will therefore basically outbreed their competition. And so when farmers and non-farmers interact, the farmers just simply overpopulate the non-farmers. And in the end, usually the non-farmers are either pushed aside or are displaced. The third aspect of this shift is a consideration of what happens with farmers who are really good. A farmer who's really good produces more food than he needs to maintain his family. Therefore, he produces a surplus. And it's what happens to that surplus that is really important in development of different kinds of cultures. And so there's several kinds of things that happen. One kind of thing that happens is that people develop governments. There's a government that is able to deal with the surplus. Sometimes the government is there to help distribute the surplus amongst people who don't have as much. In addition to development of a government, or coincidental with development of a government, sometimes there's development of the military. And so a military can either be developed to protect the surplus that you have, or to and in order to defend you from other people who might want to take it, or it might be developed because you don't have a surplus, but your neighbor does, and you want to go take his surplus. You want to make him share with you. In either case, a military is oftentimes a secondary development of a food surplus. One of the interesting points that supports this is that there's not evidence of standing armies or of any kind of substantial military activities amongst hunter-gatherer peoples and others who don't practice some kind of farming of domesticates, whether that be plants or animals. So once again, when we have two cultures who come in contact with each other, the culture that has the most highly developed farming system, not only are they dependent upon that farming system, but they probably also have a government that helps to organize them and organize the surplus of their food, and they probably also have a military. And so when one culture has a military and the other one really doesn't, you can imagine what happens. This map shows migrations that would have occurred a long time ago within the continent of Africa. Notice it shows once again the origin of humans in East Africa and shows people moving north along the upper parts of Africa into Europe, across into Asia, and on down towards South Africa and towards the west into Western Africa. This map illustrates what is probably the more recent pattern of movement of people within Africa. And there's probably been lots and lots of movements of people within Africa. Most of them are lost in prehistory, and we don't really know where people went or how they went. We have a certain amount of evidence that remains from genetics and from linguistics, doing comparisons between languages in different places. But a lot of that record is probably lost and will never be recovered. In particular, what this map shows is the distribution of two groups of people within Africa. We have one group of people moving within the northern part of Africa that includes people such as Berbers and Arabs moving in and around. Secondly, we have what's referred to as the Bantu expansion that begins in East Africa and moves throughout the central part of Africa and then to the north and south. And in fact, during the colonial period, we actually have a time when the Bantu are expanding towards South Africa, and it happens to be at the same time that Europeans have colonized South Africa and are moving north out of South Africa. And the two of these come into conflict. And of course, there's much history written about this particular conflict. And in fact, the countries of South Africa, Zimbabwe, and Southwest Africa, or Namibia, are all kind of lingering relics of this expansion of two different colonial groups, the Bantu coming south and the Europeans going north, and the interaction between these two peoples. The final point that's illustrated on this map that I think is interesting is the movement of peoples coming from the Pacific Islands, the Indo-Pacific region, coming over and colonizing Madagascar. as well as people from Africa colonizing Madagascar. Within Madagascar, we have the very interesting situation where we have a cultural and genetic mixture of people from Africa and the Pacific Islands speaking a language, Malagas, that is an Austronesian language or related to languages such as Hawaiian, but physically looking like people from Africa. When we consider Asia, and particularly the south and central parts of Asia, we can see that there are six major distribution events that have occurred. The first of these would have happened a very long time ago, maybe a million years ago, of people moving from the African region across through the Middle East and into areas such as India and southern China. Next, we have people moving on down into the Indo-Malaysian peninsulas and out into Indonesia and the areas of Malaysia and the Philippines. A third distribution that we have is actually composed of a number of waves, and in fact probably all of these are. This happens to be people moving down the Korean Peninsula and out into Japan. And probably the earliest waves are quite ancient. Some of the more recent waves include the movement of people who make up the modern Japanese society, who moved down through Korea and out into Japan and displaced people who physically looked different. Probably relic populations are still present living in mountains such as the Ainu and in Okinawa. A fourth distribution of people, I'm going to discuss more in a moment, is wave after wave of people coming out of the Russian steppe. The classic example of these are Mongol hordes invading China. And this is something that certainly happened time and time again. And in fact, it happened so often that the Chinese built the Great Wall of China to defend themselves from waves of these people coming down out of the Russian steppe. As it turns out, you can't build a wall big enough to stop people. They're just going to keep moving anyway. But it's part of this movement of people. People are not stagnant. Fifth, we have people moving out of the area of southern China into Taiwan. This is another event that has happened repeatedly through time, with, of course, the most recent one being Mandarin-speaking Chinese moving from China to Taiwan. But there were people who lived there long before that, and they happened to speak a group of languages that we call Austronesian languages. These people subsequently moved out of Taiwan, down through the Philippines, on out into the Pacific Islands, into Indonesia, and these are the same people who ultimately went to Madagascar. I want to focus next on the migration patterns of people in the Indo-Pacific region. As I said, this began with people moving out of the area of southern China into Taiwan, and then on out into the Pacific. But there's actually an earlier movement of people that is equally interesting. And this consists of people moving a very long time ago, down through Indonesia, out into what is now called New Guinea, and on down into Australia and as far as Tasmania. The division between these two is actually the division between what is referred to as near and remote Oceania. To get into near Oceania, you could pretty much walk on land the whole way during the Pleistocene. So people could walk all the way from Asia, almost all the way to Tasmania. Now there's a few places in there where you have to cross water, but it's not that far, and you could usually see from one island to the next, because there was a lot more land exposed during the Pleistocene, because so much water was in glaciers on land. So this distribution of people probably was many waves. We don't know how many waves of people it was. The second distribution, the one I've pointed out already, of people moving out of southern China, took place mostly by water, where people were moving in fast-moving canoes. This group of people spoke Austronesian languages, and they were able to spread over the largest area of the earth of any ancient distribution of languages. And so today we find that speakers of Austronesian languages are found in Madagascar, adjacent to Africa, and in Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, adjacent to South America, and everywhere in between. And so this represents the largest distribution of people. On this map, you can see the general pattern of how people moved out into Oceania and distributed themselves throughout the regions that we know of as Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia. Another big movement of peoples is into the areas of North and South America. Now, there are functionally three waves of people that moved into the Americas. A very early wave of people, maybe 15 to 25,000 years ago, moved out of the area of Siberia down through areas that were either free of ice or along the edges of ice pack, down through North America, all the way down through South America, and as far south as Tierra del Fuego. There's a lot of discussion about exactly when these people went and who they were, but they clearly went a long ways. The second big movement of people was another group of people moving out of the areas of Asia and moving into North America, probably after glaciations that had receded and at a time when there was more abundant food resources available and it was easier to get around in North America. Third group of people represents a very recent movement of people also out of Northern Asia. And these are people who had developed special skills in the hunting of sea mammals and in survival in very cold areas. This is a relatively recent development and represents some very highly specialized skills. And they moved all the way across into the areas of Greenland, but stayed largely within the Arctic zones. A fourth and minor component that is difficult to detect and may or may not actually exist is movements of people out of Europe in ancient times. We know that certain Viking groups did move into Iceland, where they remain till today, and into Greenland, and into small parts of Canada. What's difficult to say is how long these people persisted and exactly how far they penetrated. Some people have argued that they penetrated as far as the west coast of the United States, and others have argued that point. It's hard to say, and it's hard to say when they came and what they did. There are also other arguments about people having moved even earlier out of parts of Europe, coming across during the glaciated periods, but the evidence for this is rather slim. Finally, one of the more interesting movements of people is a phenomena wherein peoples have, over long, long periods of time, built up in populations in Central Asia and then moved out either into Europe, into Africa, or into Eastern Asia. The steppes of Central Asia are a very interesting place for the development of culture and distribution of ideas about plants and animals. Within Central Asia, we have the domestication of animals such as sheep, and we probably have development of some of the earliest forms of wool that were useful for making clothing. We also have domestication of horses, and a suite of plants that most people find rather entertaining. This is a combination of cannabis, opium poppies, and ephedra. And so you have kind of your upper and your downer and your ease the minder, maybe. And when you put all this together, and you mix it with the fact that these people also developed the art of practicing warfare from horseback, you have people who have a very interesting combination of medicinal plants and are herders who can fight battles on horseback. And these people have periodically swooped down out of their steppes into either Europe or into Asia or into the Middle East. So for instance, we have people moving into the Middle East called Hittites, who invaded as far as Egypt and represent some of these people from this part of the world. We have Mongol hordes sweeping down into China. We have other groups coming down into India, and we have wave after wave of people labeled as barbarians coming in across Eastern Europe and as far as Rome and Germany. One of the interesting effects of people moving repeatedly out of Central Asia and basically pushing and displacing other peoples off to the edges is that when we look at the edges, the western edges of Europe, the southern edges of Asia, and the southern edges of Africa, we find peoples who are much more ancient and represent populations that have been displaced by these wave after wave of people being pushed out of Central Asia. Therefore, we would expect to find people who are speaking unusual ancient languages in the edges of these of this supercontinent area. So, for instance, we find some of the oldest Gaelic languages in Scotland, Ireland, and the Isle of Man. We find segregate languages that we can't really link with other languages, such as Basque in the edge of Spain and France and Portugal. And we find other unusual languages as isolates in Southeast Asia and southern India. Since about the 1500s, there's been a steady wave of global colonization. And this global colonization is actually quite a bit different than colonizations that we see in the past. It has been much more rapid, in fact, so rapid that I doubt there will be any evidence of movement in the archaeological record. It'll be a single event horizon that's basically global in effect. And this represents not just the movement of people, not just the distribution of obscure languages such as English and French and Spanish that prior to 1500 were only spoken in very small parts of the world and now are spoken over most of the world, but it's also the distribution of plants, animals, diseases, and ideas. And so this is a very complex phenomena that we see happening. Basically, never before in the history of humans have these kinds of distributions happened so fast, nor have distributions of plants and animals happened so evenly. In the past, there's always been an uneven distribution of resources. Now, virtually every plant and animal that's been domesticated is available to people everywhere in the world, and this has never been the case before. This has led to a lot of kind of globalization events where we see people's becoming more homogenized in the diets that they eat, in the ways that they're earning livings, and in the ways that they think and talk about the world. Some people consider this to be a really great thing. Everybody's coming together. But for those of us who are interested in conserving the diversity of culture, the diversity of languages, the diversity of plants and animals, this is really a mixed blessing, because we actually see more loss of diversity than we see benefit from the globalization effect. In summary, what we see is that differential cultural survival around the world is linked with the kinds of interactions that we have with both plants and animals. And in particular, the intensification of interactions that happens between people and plants in the domestication process that has led to farming and other kinds of intensification. Secondly, the distributions of cultures that we see around the world are the results of both ancient and modern movements of peoples. And these movements are not things that happened at one point in time, but they happened over long periods of time, and there's been a lot of mixing that has occurred. There's actually very few places in the world that we can point to the people who were there and with a great deal of confidence say, those are the first people who ever got to that place. Now, in the Pacific Islands, this is actually a lot easier because these are some of the last places that were colonized by humans on Earth. And then lastly, traditional knowledge of plants has been maximized by cultures given the limitations of local environments. We're fairly confident that people have learned to domesticate just about everything that they could around them. And in fact, there's pretty good evidence that shows that of the domesticated crops that are out there, which are hundreds of plants, and of the domesticated animals, people had domesticated just about everything that they possibly could by about 5,000 years ago. So people have really maximized the availability, people have really maximized the resources that they harness from the environment around them. So now, returning to some of our big questions, why are cultures different? Well, at least in part, cultures are different because of the kinds of resources that they've had available to them and the ways in which they've been able to interact with those resources. Cultures are also different because of the interactions that they've had with other cultures, whether they were on the winning end of an interaction or on the losing end has affected the trajectory of a particular culture. Why was there variation in usage of plants and technologies in the past? Probably the biggest reason for variation was that there was a variation in the distribution of the plants themselves, and therefore there was a variation in the usage of plants. Why were technologies varied? Well, there's a little bit of a circular buildup that happens. The more plants you have available, the easier it is for you to develop technologies that use plants, and obviously the more technologies you have, the easier it is for you to develop more plants to use with them. And so it's a kind of a cycle that builds, and a chicken and an egg phenomena. How are we all related? Well, this is a big mystery and one that's heavily argued. Geneticists have developed maps that show distributions of human genetics, but I suspect it's actually much more complex than that, and that the simple distribution of the genome is not a satisfactory answer to most people. Others look at how languages are distributed, and they say that we are distributed, you can track our distributions based upon language families and groupings. And once again, this is not terribly satisfying, given that many people around the world today speak as their first language, a language that their grandparents or great-grandparents had never even heard of. So languages may not be the best way to track things as well. And we will show you later on in this course that plants can be used to track people. This also is not satisfactory because plants can jump from one community to another and they don't necessarily represent movements of people, although they do clearly represent movements of plants.